Hello, my name is Pete Gerlach. I've been a professional family therapist for 31 years, and part of that work has led me to try and understand what does it take to have an effective, mutually satisfying relationship between any two people. One aspect of doing that has recently come to light in the last 25 years or so. It is the dynamic called enabling. So in this video, I want to offer you some perspective on what I have learned about this relationship dynamic in case it is affecting you and your life. Enabling first came into wide-scale public attention back in the 1980s. At that time, there was an explosion of awareness and interest in alcoholism. It began to be recognized that alcoholism was not a personal disease or a character flaw. In fact, it was an overt indication of major family dysfunction. It was a family problem as well as an individual problem. Part of the awareness that bloomed at that time was of the dynamic called co-alcoholism, which was symbolized by widespread example was a husband who was badly hungover in the morning asks his wife to call his boss and tell the boss, "Oh, Henry is sick, he can't come in today, he'll be in tomorrow." Henry, suffering from a hangover, asks his wife to lie for him because he, Henry, doesn't want to confront the boss and admit to himself or the boss that he has a serious health problem. That was a widespread example that helped people begin to understand what is, in the context of relationships, what is this thing called enabling, which incidentally is different than empowering, bringing out the best in people. So that's where enabling came from in the 1980s. Since that time, the public and mental health people have come to realize enabling applies to all kinds of unhealthy behavior, not just addiction. So it is now recognized that many people enable each other or themselves without knowing it or without meaning to or without knowing how to stop. That's why I'm making this video. There are two things that we can enable in each other and ourselves. The first is harmful attitudes. Can you think of an example in your life of a harmful attitude that you may hold or someone else does? How about the attitude, it's okay to lie once in a while, it's okay to steal, it's okay to cheat. Hey, if you can get away with it, it's no problem, it's okay, go ahead. Cheat on your taxes, that's all right. That's a harmful attitude. People get hurt because of it. The second of two things that we enable are behaviors. There's lots and lots of examples. One that strikes the public heartstrings is abuse. People who unintentionally or intentionally hurt a dependent person, a young person or a disabled person, or someone who's too scared or confused to defend themselves. Abusive, aggressive behavior, if not confronted, is a sign of enabling. So, those are the things that you can enable in yourself and other people. Why do we enable? Why do people do this? I propose there are three specific reasons. They're all related. The first, not many people are willing to admit, which is the widespread existence of major psychological wounds from early childhood trauma. What I mean by trauma is adult abuse, abandonment, and neglect. Those are massively traumatic to young children. They cause psychological wounds, which without intervention, kids grow up and bring right into adulthood. One of the wounds is excessive fear. excessive fear prevents many of us from confronting someone who's doing harmful things to themselves or other people. So the wound of excessive fear is one root. The other root is reality distortion. That's a second wound that many of us come into adulthood with. The most prominent example of reality distortion, there are several different kinds. If you're curious, see my video on reality distortion. One of the most popular is denial. Oh, I'm not enabling, is the chief denial that we're talking about here. Or, it's okay to deny. That's a reality distortion. It's okay to enable. In this case, no harm, minimal harm, no big deal. That's denial, and it's reality distortion. Fear and reality distortion cause enabling. So does ignorance. Ignorance is lack of knowledge. People don't know about psychological wounds, about childhood trauma. They don't know about excessive fear. They don't know about reality distortion. And if they do know, they don't know what to do about them. So ignorance of those things and of the dynamic of enabling itself is a second cause that we enable each other. The third of three roots is unawareness. People may know about wounds, fear, denial, and enabling, but they're simply because they're distracted, they're unaware that they're doing it, or they're unaware of the consequences of doing it. And they may not want to be aware, which is part of the wounding. So those are three reasons, in my opinion, why so many people, adults and kids, enable themselves and each other. The opposite to enabling, by the way, is confrontation. It's stepping up to the person who's doing the harmful behavior or has a harmful attitude. It's stepping up to them and confronting them. How do you feel about confrontation? Are you an experienced, confident, respectful confronter? Do you do confrontations well? Are you comfortable with confronting people? Are you over-aggressive? Are you shy? Are you submissive? Do you hint? How do you go about confronting, if at all? To learn more about how you can confront effectively, which is one way of helping people not enable each other, I hope you'll see my video. I'll give you the link at the end of this video. So learn how to assert and confront. That's the opposite of enabling. What are the costs of enabling? I propose that there are two major costs, and they're expensive. The first one is your own self-respect. If you have some degree of awareness that someone else is doing harmful behavior or has a harmful attitude, and you don't do anything about it, I suspect you have an inner critic who says, bad, bad, you're bad. You should. You're not doing the right thing. You're wrong. You're bad. If you have a, quote, guilty conscience, your self-esteem, self-respect, self-love takes a major hit if you allow someone else to harm themselves or some other person or persons. That's one of two major costs. The second cost is the persons who are being harmed could have been helped if you did something about it. They might or might not have gotten help, but they'd never have the chance if you don't confront. Those are two major costs which you have to live with as long as you choose to enable. So you might say, well, yuck, how can I avoid enabling? I propose with compassion, the first thing you can do is ask the question, am I enabling myself? That may be an alien concept. What I'm saying is, Are you ignoring or not confronting harmful attitudes about your own health? Are you ignoring your attitude about, I don't have to go to the gym and work out three times a week. I can eat saturated fat. I can eat lots of carbohydrates. I can use a lot of salt. I can use alcohol and other drugs. No big deal. Life is short. Live it to the fullest while you can. Ho-hum. The best chance you have for discovering if you unintentionally are enabling yourself is to learn about psychological wounds from a traumatic childhood. To do that, I invite you to study these videos from Lesson 1 in my nonprofit educational website. Here's the link. Here's also the link that you can follow to read the same articles or similar articles on that ad-free self-improvement website. Here's the link. The second thing you can do is to see if there are people in your life who are harming themselves or other people by their attitudes or behaviors. Stop and think about the people that you are regularly in contact with or irregularly. People in your family, friends, people you work with, colleagues, people in your community. If they are harming themselves through self-neglect or self-abuse, and or if they are harming other people, particularly dependent kids or disabled people, ask yourself, how do you feel about confronting them on their attitudes or behaviors? Then ask yourself, if you have not confronted them, how do you feel about not confronting them? If you're feeling significantly numb or guilty or ashamed, improve the odds of regaining your self-respect and potentially helping them and or the people they are harming through improving your ability to confront. Study this video and study this video on learning how to confront people or how to assert your needs and opinions respectfully and effectively. If you want more information, see my nonprofit website and study the lessons on effective assertion. That's part of Lesson 2. So there's a lot you can do to reduce enabling with yourself or with other people. I hope you found this video instructive, thought-provoking, and motivational. I encourage you, learn more, assess yourself for wounds, improve your ability to confront yourself and other people. Thanks for watching.